Welcome to the video. This is Clarity Ross. First, I'd like to give full credit to my teachers who are Sri Anandamayi Ma, Jesus Christ, and Muji, and my spiritual friend Ramana Maharshi. All of them can take credit for wherever I am at, and they all are working for the principle of God's grace, which I call the Holy Spirit. You can call it the grace of God. All comes from God, the prime creator. All intended to free us from our mad attempt to be prime creators. We are the prime created. We're spirit. We're not the prime creator. We didn't create endlessness. We are endlessness, but we didn't create endlessness. We are the one identity. We didn't create the one identity. There's a difference there. It's not a qualitative difference. It's just a factual difference. A difference in authority. What we're trying to do is we're trying to usurp the authority of God, the prime creator, and make it our own. And to this extent, we are attempting to come up with a replacement for reality, which is what existence is, this universe. It's symbolic, it's hypothetical scenario. We are working to try and come up with a replacement. Replacement identity. And that's why we are all frazzled. Because it's impossible to accomplish. This is my basic teaching. This is what I've been schooled in. This is what the Holy Spirit has directed my attention to. Slightly different emphasis than most teachers. But I feel it's a very valuable one, very helpful. Because it's very factual. Puts you on a very stable basis. You're able to look at the non-dual teachings, other teachers, and you say, ah, I see exactly what they're saying. Yes, absolutely. Drop the false identity. But what is the false identity? It's actually an attempt to replace the true identity. It's not that there are lots of separate identities and they're all kind of joined together. No, there's only one identity shared by everything that arises. Everything that arises shares that one identity with everything else. There's not separate identities that are somehow joined. That's not true. But we, as spirit, had the idea of being prime creators, so we wanted to bring God's creation to an end so that then we could start a new one. So we're trying to do two different things kind of at the same time, simultaneously. Package deal, where we're trying to bring endlessness to an end, and then we're trying to fashion a replacement for endlessness. Something of our own manufacturing. So you see in this world, constructivity and destructivity ceaselessly taking place. The destructivity is trying to develop a power of negation that can negate endlessness, bring endlessness to an end. And the constructivity, part of it is to try and work on developing, progressing towards a template for a new creation. The reason why we're so frazzled is we're trying to incorporate both truth and lies, integrate them. And I'm speaking to those on the spiritual path because those are the ones that are attracted to this teaching. Very difficult, spiritual path, very difficult. Because for a long time we tried to integrate both the attempt to start a new creation and integrate the creation that already is. We call the attempt to be prime creators the ego. That's just a term that's easy to use in speech. So some ego is just the sum total of all marketing efforts, marketing this idea and playing it out. It's really the mind that's doing all this as a servant of spirit's idea. Mind is not a free agent. It's giving rise to this hypothetical scenario we call existence. And when you get on the spiritual path, what you do is you try to keep both the ego and the Holy Spirit happy. The Holy Spirit's the one that shows us that you cannot bring an end to endlessness. So give up this futility. It's all futile. It's all impossible. Your identity is the one identity still perfectly untouched by efforts to fragment it and destroy it, and simply to abide in that one identity. That's the Holy Spirit leads spirit back to that, truth, into acceptance of it. But the ego, what the ego does, very clever, the marketing devices of the mind, says, the ego says, well, that's not fair. I want to, let's share co-creation. Let's be co-creators, the ego and God. Let them be co-prime creators. And then the ego says, what we're doing here is we're integrating the two creations together, and it'll be better than either one of them. It's a very good marketer and salesperson. And so our poor, troubled spirit that's trying to sort this out, saying, oh boy, what do I do? You know, it's so difficult, the spiritual path, and it's very confusing, because the ego acts like it's the authority, equal authority to God. And if it's not equal, it's on its way to being equal. And it insists that God is being unfair, that God doesn't want to share authority, that God should share authority with the ego. And therefore, we're trying to find a way for both the ego and God to be prime creator. And this is what brings, you know, enormous difficulty and stress on the spiritual path, because you're trying to please both. And it causes your mind to work ceaselessly, overtime. A lot of people cannot sleep. Their mind is feverishly working, trying to come up with a plan of integration, how to integrate truth and lies. And somehow come up with a third possibility, a greater than both. This is a very tough nut to crack. This causes incredible suffering on the path. You know that you're making progress when you are able to see through this more and more and more. See through this deception. Now, the fact is, I've said in other videos on Christ Clarity channel, on YouTube user, Christ Clarity, that the way to salvation, the way out of this horrible torment and dilemma of trying to please both the ego and God, is to resist not evil and love everything the way it is. This specifically, most importantly, refers to the ego. Do not resist the ego and everything it's doing. Why? Because if you resist it, that is essentially fueling it, giving it the fuel it needs to strengthen its authority in your belief. Because when you resist the ego, that essentially indicates that you're worried about its capability and capacity to usurp power from God. Jesus said, perfect love casteth out all fear. That's the perfect teaching. In other words, what is love? Love is all-inclusive, like the sun shining on everything equally. It's not resisting anything. It's endlessness, overflowing endlessness. It's not concerned about what arises or doesn't arise. With this love, the ego evaporates because there's nothing to feed it. It says to the ego that there's no problem. The ego's not causing any problem. Furthermore, here's something that's even more important, getting down to the nitty-gritty now. The ego was born of a lie, and so it believes in lies. What is the lie? The lie is that effect can separate from cause. Obviously, if spirit's going to be prime creator, spirit being the prime created, has to separate from the prime creator, has to believe in the capability of an effect, spiritual effects, which is what spirit is, separating from spiritual cause, which is what God the prime creator is. Have to believe that. That is the premise of the notion of spirit being prime creator, is that effect, spiritual effect, can separate from spiritual cause. That's the premise that the ego was born from. So the ego totally believes and is incapable of not believing this, that effect can separate from cause. The ego believes that it can be changed. Therefore, the ego believes it can change. It can change its beliefs. The ego was born of the belief that effect can separate from cause, which is a false belief. And the ego says, well, no problem. I can always just separate from that. You see how tricky that is? And that pulls you in. You think, oh, I can work with the ego, because the ego says it can change. Not true. Of course, we want the ego to change, don't we? So we side with that, the ego saying, yeah, I can change, I can change. I can take the spiritual path, I can be enlightened, etc. And so we then think, okay, we can integrate, we can work with the ego, and that's the trap the ego sets for you. The ego cannot change. The ego will always be a liar. The ego cannot separate from the cause, from the idea that gave birth to it. The idea that gave birth to it is a false belief, a false idea that spirit can be prime creator. The ego will always be true to that. But since the idea is that effects can separate, the ego insists that it doesn't have to be true to that, true to its cause. It can change its allegiance. It cannot. That's the big lie. That's the big lie that trips us all up. Because the ego seems to talk such a great game. Yeah, I can do this. Yeah, I can do that. Yeah, no problem. Integrate into reality, no problem. The ego even says it can be enlightened, that it can know truth, understand truth. All this, not true. The ego's not. The ego is just a marketing campaign. The marketing campaign is marketing the idea that effects can separate from cause. That's a lie. It's an untruth. It's a dream. It's a fantasy. It's a hypothetical scenario. It can never be true. Spirit cannot separate from God the Prime Creator. And the idea of separating from God the Prime Creator brings forth a marketing campaign called the ego, which cannot separate from that idea. So the ego will always be true to its belief that it can change, that it can separate, that it can therefore share authority with God, that it can be anything that you want it to be. Not true. It can only be a liar. It can only be a deceiver. There's no way it can be anything else. So, the idea of loving it the way that it is means accept the ego the way that it is. Because it cannot change. It cannot change. So love is all-inclusive right now. It's not waiting for any change to happen. That's the genius of Jesus' advice. Don't resist evil. In other words, don't resist the ego. Don't expect it to be able to change. Accept the way it is right now, that it's a born liar and deceiver and will always be so. And the way to get free of it is don't attempt to change it, which then clarifies and brings forth the fact that you believe that cause and effect cannot be separated. And therefore, you cannot be separated from God the Prime Creator, which means you cannot be Prime Creator, which means you can drop the whole stupid attempt to be so. It's a beautiful, beautiful momentum creator right there. It's March 2nd today. Very, very important day. It's important to get this momentum going, to realize the momentum is there. It really is. The teachings, the fundamental teachings of Jesus is resist not evil. Perfect love casteth out all fear. If you don't have love, you don't really have anything. It's the most important thing. Meaning that all-inclusive, accept everything the way it is right now. Don't try to change anything. The ego tempts you into trying to change it. The ego says, tells you that it can be changed if you just work at it. And so we're all feverishly working on trying to change something on the spiritual path, trying to bring out some sort of change. That's not it. That's the temptation that leads us astray. If we can accept everything just the way that it is right now, we will feel this feeling of love. It doesn't have any words to describe it. The ever-present fullness of endlessness. Now, moving on. What else can generate momentum for us? Because as I said, March 2nd, from this day forward, things are really going to heat up in the world. Really, really ratcheting up a whole nother octave. As if that were possible, and it is possible. We know the culture wars are really heating up. All of this, the flames of people's intolerance are being fanned. Flames of their hatred, their passion, their desire to change something are being fanned. Love has no desire to change anything. If we wanted peace to prevail right now, we would spend our time with this, simply abiding in this feeling of love, which is what the goal of this video, my channels, and everything I'm doing is aimed towards, that abiding in this love. Ramana Maharshi calls it the self. Abide in the self. And the self is not trying to change anything. There's no need to. Because God is not threatened by an idea that it can be threatened. Okay? Endlessness is untouched by any idea that it can end. So it doesn't need to oppose such ideas. It doesn't need to get out of its all-inclusiveness, complete serene stability. It doesn't need to think or believe that it needs to defend anything. Nothing needs to be defended. Truth doesn't need to be defended at all. As soon as we try to defend it, we're feeding the ego's belief that it can separate. Separation is possible. And then that causes us fear. So perfect love casts out all fear. If you allow this true love, this true all-inclusiveness, without any thought about what's included or not included, all-inclusiveness, because it's endless. Endlessness includes everything inherently. If we allow that, that casts out all fear. And that is what's needed in this world right now, because the ego is fanning the flames. Fanning the passions of the world, whatever it is, from every angle. You know, you can start a little fire. When you add wind to it and you fan the flames, it starts getting hotter and spreading. That's what the ego is doing right now, and it is really, everybody seems to be jumping into this fire right now. And I'm telling you for sure, don't do it. That's why I have this channel here. I'm broadcasting live. I always have on Ustream. ustream.tv/channel/Christ-clarity. That's where I do live broadcasting. I like to have something up constantly during the day. Anytime you go there should be something that you can watch. And this will draw you away from jumping into that fire. Back away from it. Back away from those who are agitating right now. Clarifying is one thing, agitating is another. I do give clarity about the times and events that we're in right now, but I don't agitate, just the opposite. I tell you to turn to love, to perfect love, accept that. Now, how do you accept perfect love? What is it? It simply is the fact that endlessness, the quality of endlessness, the fact of endlessness is omnipresent everywhere and every time. An equal quality, equal amount. It's all equal, equally present. Some say that realizing this is called equal vision. Meaning that, let's say, a trillion years in the past, in the way we're looking at time, endlessness was exactly the same way as it is right now. And trillions of years in the future will be exactly the way that it is now. No change whatsoever. Endlessness can't be changed in any way. Because it's always transcending itself. And it means that a trillion light years from where you're sitting or standing or walking right now, endlessness, the quality of endlessness, is exactly the same there as it is right where you are. No difference whatsoever. So no matter where you go, what you do, or when you do it, the quality of reality will be exactly the same as it is right now. There will be no change whatsoever, ever. That is what love is. That is what abiding in love means, abiding in that fact, in the realization of that fact. And if you consider it, you realize, you say, what am I waiting for? It's very profound. It's exactly right here now, as it's going to be exactly the same as any other time, any other place, any other situation. Will never change. So what do I gain by waiting? And you ask yourself that, you realize nothing. That quickens you. That's called the quickening. This realization acts as a quickening agent, and which is what you need right now. We all need to be quickened. You can call it the quickening. I call it the big boost. Maybe I'll call it the quickening. We need this big boost. We need to abide in love instead of judgment. Love doesn't need to judge. Love already knows. The ego's a liar. Cause and effect cannot be separated. Endlessness cannot be brought to an end. Endlessness cannot be touched by anything that arises within it. Reality is perfectly stable. Can never be harmed or changed in any way. Cannot be distorted. Cannot be corrupted. Cannot be injured. Cannot be defiled, degraded, anything. Cannot, it is totally, exactly as it's always been and always will be. So that fact is true right now. It's true in all the moments that you've lived through. It's been exactly the same truth there. It will be exactly the same truth in all the moments that you will live through in the future. Exactly the same. No change. No change whatsoever. The more that we realize this fact, the more this feeling of begins to fill us, begins to dawn on us. Like, wow, I really am safe. I'm home. I simply need to sink down into that home, to relax into it. It's not a physical relaxation or a mental, emotional, etc. It's a spiritual relaxation. It has a different quality to it. A lot of us try to get this relaxation through manipulating the mind, using the mind to relax the emotions and the body and all that, but that's not it. That's the ego. What we're looking for is a spiritual relaxation. We realize the truth. It has a different feel to it. And we need to realize that right away. Since the future we know won't change anything about our identity at all. Our identity is perfectly available, perfectly is right now. Future is not going to make the slightest dent in that at all. So what are we waiting for? Why do we need to go through all our concern as we go through these future events? Why do we need to go through them in a state of concern, a state of worry, a state of defensiveness, a state of needing, feeling we need to do something about it? We can go through it in a state of love. Divine love. A state of perfect calm, poise, unconcern, stability, peace, joy, all of that. We can be that every moment, effortlessly. We need this quickening agent to help us get to this quickly. And these videos are intended for that purpose. And they need to be accelerated. The outreach needs to be accelerated. You don't want to go through the future of this planet without abiding in love. In this resistless state, a state where you're not resisting anything. You realize there's no need to resist anything. You know this is all a lie, all false, all a hypothetical scenario. There's no identity in any of it. The I is not an identity. It's just a presumption of an identity. It's just a labeling. It's a wish, a hope, a hypothetical identity. There is no identity in existence other than the one identity, which is omnipresent. Whether existence arises or not makes absolutely no difference to it. It doesn't affect it in any way. Whether this universe arises or not makes no difference to the one identity that we already are, have always been, and always will be. And we can rest in that fact and truth right now. We'll always be able to rest in that truth right now. We have no choice. It's omnipresent. Endlessness. How can endlessness be brought to an end? What could bring endlessness to an end? What is beyond endlessness? Nothing. There's no truth to that statement. There's nothing beyond endlessness. It's just a foolish wish. A foolish wish cannot establish identity. Endlessness is the one identity. That's with us right now. It's with everything right now. Don't have to do anything for that to be true. The world's going to heat up. It's already boiling, isn't it? Some point when you're cooking, you know that at some point the water gets hot. You start seeing steam rising, you see little bubbles, then the bubbles get bigger, and then the surface begins to get really agitated, and then suddenly the foam comes up, and boom, off goes the lid, right? Like you're cooking spaghetti or something. We've all had that happen where it just blows the lid right off at some point because it starts foaming. The heat starts forming all these bubbles and foaming. Okay, same thing with this world. The more that heats up, it goes through stages. Eventually it'll hit the stage, it blows the lid off. And that's when everything boils over and starts flowing all over the place and a big mess happens. You want to be in that this rock-like stability of peace beyond understanding. It doesn't come from the world, it's uncaused. It's the very inherent nature of reality. Inherent nature of identity, of what you already are. You've just been trying to come up with a replacement. Now, you might know all this is true that is being said here. I'm sure there are many of you who hear this say, yeah, I know all this, yeah. But still there's a problem. What's that problem? Very simple. You're hedging your bets. Are we, collectively, all of us, because we're all doing the same thing, we're hedging our bets. We're saying, well, this is true, yes, but what if endlessness did come to an end or could come to an end? I just want to work on a replacement for it just in case. Even though I don't believe it can come to an end, why not at least have something in my back pocket just in case it does? So that's the trap. That's the final obstacle because we say, you know, I can be enlightened any moment I want to. That's very true, I know that. But why not work just a little bit longer on coming up with a replacement for reality, just in case? So at least I know, then I'll be doubly secure. So we want to be doubly secure. So we say, yeah, we have the perfect security of reality, and in case reality comes to an end, we have the perfect security of knowing that we have a replacement for it. Replacement identity. Replacement, an entire replacement. Everything that arises, a new prime creator, new prime created, new experiencing, new rules, new everything. We have it all set up. That's the big problem. That is the final obstacle to hedging our bets. So, that's a tough one. Because no matter what anyone says, you can agree with it and say, yeah, okay, endlessness can never end. But it would be fun. Why not at least have an option? What's the harm in that? Well, there's no harm. But as long as you're continuing to pursue an option, you cannot possibly experience reality, experience the one identity, love, endlessness, as it is. Because if you experience it as it is, you will know that it cannot ever come to an end, and then it's completely useless, foolish, waste of time to pursue an option, an alternative. You will know it. So you can't experience it as it is. What you can do is experience a facsimile of it. The mind will try to generate some kind of facsimile for you so you can continue to work on the option. But that is full of stress. Since it's concept-based, it is completely vulnerable. The mind will start blaming others for its vulnerability, for its lack of stability, of this conceptual mirage for you. And then that will get you into the blame game, and you will start easily be fanned into activism and upset and anger and attack mode to that which is causing you what you feel is instability. You'll get sucked into it, pulled into it. So it's a very dangerous thing to sit on the fence and try to pursue this alternative, even though you know it's not necessary, not really necessary. And I would say the vast majority of spiritual pilgrims are in that position. Haven't really committed. Still on the fence. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to get off the fence. Fence is not a good place to be in, ever. Especially now. Because there are experts in this world at fanning the flames. When you want to build a fire, you get the firewood, you put the newspaper, the lighter fluid, whatever, that really ignites the flame, and then the flame ignites the wood, and if you stacked up all the wood ahead of time, it's a big bonfire, and then you have these, you know, blowers that blow air into it that just give it more oxygen. So all of the fire set up ahead of time has already happened in this world. All the firewood's been set up already. The attitudes, the polarizations, they're all there. So the firewood's there. All that's necessary is for the flame to be lit. And the flame is getting lit. You know, if you have a huge fire, you light it in many places all around, a circle, and then you start blowing air onto it, right? So now the lighting is happening and the air is being blown onto it. The flames are being fanned so it can catch, the kindling can catch fire and start burning real hot, and then that'll catch the big logs on fire. We know how it works. Same thing here in this world, that's how it works. You have experts that come into this world that are experts at fanning the flames of attack, of hostility, of destructivity. And of course, it's all done under a cloak of righteousness. People don't quite understand what's happening. But it's meant to bring about a vast conflagration. On this planet. It's all by design. It's all part of the ego's marketing strategy. The ego never deviates from marketing to spirit, the notion that spirit can come up with a way to end endlessness and can replace reality with a new reality of its own fashion, own manufacturing, own creation. The ego never deviates from that. But it's extremely clever and devious in the ways that it goes about it. Because it has to keep spirit interested. Spirit keeps seeing through ego's tricks and say, whoa, wait a minute, that didn't work, you know. So ego has to be very clever. And it is. And it keeps tricking spirit, and it's tricking spirit right now. Spirit's looking at the situation and saying, you know, I see a lot of, you know, bad guys out there. Things need to be changed. And so it is then part of that fire, part of the wood and the fire, that's going to be burned. This world is really going to be burned severely at various levels. I believe it's actually going to be burned all the way down to the physical level at some point. That'll be the last thing to happen. But it's going to be burned out at the other levels, mental, emotional, etheric, and the various levels of illusion. All of those conceptual levels are going to be really burned, severely fried, and eventually that'll come all the way down to the physical level. And what's to be gained from that? Nothing. It's simply generating fake evidence to back up the plausibility of ego's story about how endlessness can be brought to an end. Because by believing that there's some sort of identity here in this world within the concepts, and then destroying those concepts, burning them, the belief is that identity is coming to an end. So then ego says to spirit, look, shouldn't be a problem to burn the one identity. It's going to happen. And the spirit says, wow, looks like, you know, something's really, a lot of progress here, a lot of momentum, a lot of, you know, momentum towards accomplishing that. And so it continues on with its fixation, asking, wanting to be prime creator, because it believes it's possible. But when spirit sees it's impossible, that all this fake evidence is accomplishing nothing, that's when the jig is up. So the spirit says, ah, forget it. I'm going to simply abide in love, the one identity. I'm going to choose the idea of non-negation, not trying to be prime creator, and just abide in the one identity blissfully. No need to oppose any foolish whims. If foolish whims want to arise, let them arise. It doesn't affect my identity at all. There's no identity in this dream of existence. None. The I is not an identity. It's just an assumed hypothetical identity for the purpose then of assumed hypothetical destruction of that identity, for the purpose of ego marketing the story to spirit about how it's possible to bring reality to an end so then spirit can be prime creator. That is the chain of dynamics that are happening for you, for all of us, and it's necessary to for spirit to break that chain, which is what we're doing here. Don't resist the ego. Don't try to change it. Don't try to make a deal with the ego. Just say, you know, Jesus said, Satan, get behind me. In other words, ego, you're a liar. I'm not going to even engage in anything you say, any promises, any deals, anything, promises you can change, all this stuff. No, you cannot change. You're a born liar and murderer and deceiver from the very beginning, which is entirely true. It will always be that way. The idea of trying to be prime creator will always have this marketing campaign of manufactured evidence of destruction, destructivity, and the idea of replacing. Of course, after destructivity comes, there's replacement, right? So the ego hooks you also on the notion that this sort of pseudo-spiritual notion that out of destructivity comes new constructivity. And you say, yeah, okay, destructivity is not so bad because it's opening the gates for a marvelous new creation to come about. Okay, that's, many get hooked that way. So, you see, what the ego story is that endlessness can be destroyed and come to an end, and then a replacement can arise that's a new creation. So, it plays out this scenario in a dream, hypothetical dream scenario, imaginary scenario of existence, where everything, you know, things come to an end, they're destroyed, and then they're replaced by something else that the ego defines as better, or at least very different, you know. And that's what's going to happen here. That's what will happen here on this planet. That is where the ego is headed, and that's where it will head. Despite its protestations that it can change its course, it cannot. The ego's set. It's fixed design. I know there's so many, again, that say, no, we can change the ego course of events here on this planet. No, you cannot. Because it's the ego's story. The ego's in charge of this story. You're not in charge of it. But you don't need to be in charge of it. You can simply bypass it all, sidestep it all, simply by realizing your true identity, realizing all this is nothing. Has absolutely nothing to do with identity. Zero. So you're not even interested in it. in terms of identities, has no relevance to you whatsoever. No relevance to any of us. And you can abide in that perfect assurance right now, because that perfect assurance is true, omni-true, omnipresent truth, all times, places, situations. So it's true right now, exactly the same as any other time, situation, place. Right now, it's perfectly true for you, perfectly true for everyone. The ego cannot change. All its story plays out the way that it has to play out. It has to bring about destruction. Has to. Because if it doesn't, spirit will just say, huh, I don't see any evidence that endlessness can be brought to an end, so I'm going to drop this crazy idea of trying to be prime creator. So the ego has to bring about massive destruction. And out of that, then after destruction, it has to bring about a new construction. It's got no choice. Because even if it brought about destruction, spirit would say, well, I mean, what about after destruction? Can I be prime creator? Can I create something new? And so the ego has to say, oh, yeah. Look, first you see the destruction, then from that you will see the new construction. That'll prove it to you. So we spirit is being dragged along through this destructive phase because it's curious and interested in what happens afterwards. But if you see the big picture, the panoramic picture of existence, you know this is just happens over and over and over and over and over again. Civilizations rise, they're destroyed, they're replaced with new civilizations that rise, and then they're destroyed, on and on and on. Same with planets, same with solar systems, galaxies, even universes. They arise, they're destroyed, and then they arise anew. It's all ego. It's all the mind. All of that's the mind. It's just marketing to spirit, to keep spirit's attention and hope and belief. It's all possible. Spirit can be prime creator, so spirit can say, yeah, I really feel I'm getting closer to it. So many will go through the destructivity that's to come very willingly because they really feel that afterwards there's going to be a new creation. Well, there'll be a new construction. That's not a new creation. There will be new constructions, of course. There are other planets, other places. On this planet, a new construction will arise. I've already seen it. Exactly what it's going to be like. It'll be very different. Very, very different. But the more things change, the more they stay the same. The ego still present. The need to build a new civilization on this planet. A complete new type of civilization here. And then that too eventually will be brought to destruction. And then something new will replace that. And the ego defines this as evolutionary progress. The expansion of spiritual consciousness, the play of God. It even so it calls it the play of God, which should bring a chuckle to you. This is all. It's not the play of God. It's the play of mind. It's the play of mind in the service of a crazy idea of bringing an end to God. You don't have to pay any interest and attention to this play at all. You can be aware of it the way you're aware like of your shadow as you walk along. How many of us are aware of our shadows? Hardly at all. But if you need to notice it, you can certainly notice the shadow. But you know it as a shadow. Shadow's not causing the person who's casting the shadow, no. It's the person's first that's casting them the shadow, right? So you can be aware of it at that level, very, very inconsequential, trivial level. But you know it has absolutely nothing to do with anything. Just a foolish, silly, whimsical, crazy, insane game that has no consequence, has no effects, it's not getting anywhere. Just an aimless, meaningless wandering around. That's all it is. And yet the ego's able to market it, to make it seem like it's some kind of divine play, that it's all going to some great harmony. That it's all working towards some greater harmony. That God is behind all of this. That's nonsense. The perfect harmony is already present. Perfection is already present in endlessness. You cannot put any labels on endlessness. You can't say that it needs to improve or expand or grow more, etc. It's even beyond any of those concepts. Endlessness is beyond endlessness. That's true right now. there's simply two directions that will take place right now. Either you take the direction of abiding in love, or you take the direction of participating in attack. Because the ego, when it fans the flames, that's the only option it gives you. The only option it's giving you is attack. Whereas the Holy Spirit gives you the option of abiding in love. Sometimes the ego makes it seem like, you know, that you can have both. And things are kind of, seem to be kind of mellow here in this world. But that's just a brief marketing strategy it's using. And it's used that already. It's used it up. I know I came from the generation of very mellow generation. We're supposed to be very mellow. Very cool. Very kind, loving. You know, you're just taking it easy. Don't get upset at anything. But that didn't last long. The ego brought in, you know, whole different, brought in its experts to build the fire. So it's not, the world's not a mellow place anymore. Doesn't matter where you think, where you are maybe seem to be mellow, but it's not really. Mellowness is not the same as abiding in love. It's not the same. It's still egoic entirely, and the ego has to manipulate that, change it, and bring it closer, move it towards destructivity. The world, the ego's game, its story, its play is in a destructive phase right now. And it will bring that about. It's a fact. There's nothing that anyone can do to stop it. Love won't stop it. Doesn't need to. Doesn't need to resist whatever's arising within it. Within the endlessness. Because as zero, if it tries to stop it, again, it's believing that somehow it can have some effect on what it is. It cannot have any effect. Why would you try to stop something that has no effect on you whatsoever? Love's already perfectly at peace and blissful, not always. So this, no matter what happens in this world, it doesn't affect that at all. Zero effect on it. So where's the motivation to try to stop anything? Instead, simply abide in this love. And then you realize you have no need to go through anything. And certainly love can provide options. That too is possible. Either options or no options. Either one doesn't change our identity whatsoever. But the option to abide in love is always there, always present. And we don't need to be concerned with details, trifles and little details. We need the big picture now. The quickening is a big picture situation, very panoramic. Sees the entirety of the situation and sees the remedy. The flames are going to heat up now. On all fronts. You know, it's like when you do start a big bonfire, you start little tiny kindling fires on the edges of it all around. And if you're only looking at that one, let's say you're in a circle around this massive bonfire, you only see maybe a couple little flames, little kindling fires where you're at, because you can't see around the whole circle. So you think, oh, there's just a couple little flames there. That's not going to burn very much. It'll take a long, long time. You don't realize that there's hundreds of little fires all around in a circle. And then suddenly when the big wind comes, like here in the West, we have a Santa Ana winds in California. And they have a lot of wildfires here, so we're very familiar with this situation. When the wind comes, the hot, dry wind comes roaring over the mountains, down through the valleys, channels of the valleys, extreme velocity, it'll take a little fire and absolutely spread it all over. So fast that firefighters can't even keep up with it. It just turned into a massive conflagration. So many homes are burned. It's a terrifying thing. So when you're seeing just a couple little fires from your perspective, you need to realize, let us realize, there are actually fires all around right now. There are hot spots everywhere. Not just militarily, but ideationally. socially, culturally, on every kind of level that there is. There are so many, many, many hot spots. Everywhere you look, if you have awareness, you see hot spots. And when the wind hits those hot spots, it will flare up. And when the wind hits all these hot spots, like orchestrates them perfectly, suddenly this bonfire will flare up extremely quickly. And before you know it, you will be singed and then torched. So what you need to do is back away from that bonfire. Get distance. Distance yourself from it. The way to do that is through perfect love, through perfect realization, of your one identity, The way to do it is what we have said during this video, and I will continue to present to you the highest teachings, the highest teachers, the best advice on how to back away from this bonfire. Don't rush in and try to put out the little fire you see in front of you, the little kindling fire, because there are hundreds and hundreds of other little kindling fires that are suddenly going to flare up, and you will be torched. So you may have a little issue. You think you can make a change in the world and say, I need to work on this issue. But you realize that their reactions are passionate now. They're going more and more passionate. If you look at the internet's always been a place that brings out the bully in people, you know, and brings out a lot of nastiness. But, you know, right now you see it's being expanded in ever greater hostility. Ever greater fury. I'm telling you, the difference between this type of rhetoric, communication between people, and the difference between when I grew up and the mellow time where people really, truly made a great effort to be kind to one another and very civil. I mean, the incivility is simply unthinkable to me. The way I grew up, and I know my parents' generation, the incivility that we had was unthinkable to them, and we were very kind and mellow. So we have gone light years away from the type of civility that holds the fabric of civilization together. It's gone. It's been burned. And the internet fans the flames of this incivility severely. People seems like they don't even have a notion of it anymore. It's only a quote-unquote us old-timers that have it. But you need to go beyond civility to perfect love. Civility isn't enough because no one pays it any heed anymore. I've tried. I've tried to cool things down. Believe me, I've made great efforts. Totally unsuccessful. I was met with fury, you know, because the ego doesn't want things to be cooled down. It doesn't want this beautiful civility to be used anymore. And it's in charge at that level. It's in charge of the mind, but we're beyond the mind. We're spirit. What we're using here are spiritual truths. The ego cannot oppose those really at all. Can't do anything about it because you're not resisting the ego. You just say, ego, you're a liar, and I don't even. That's it. That's as far as I need to go. I know you can never change. I don't care what you say. Everything you say, the fact that you say you can change is a lie. All the false evidence that you can change, again, it's just delay. Just you're leading me around in circles. I'm not going to do that anymore. You take the wind out of its sails. Love the ego the way it is. Meaning, allow your true identity, abide in your true identity right now without having to try and change anything about the ego, anything it's doing one way or the other. Good, bad, or ugly, indifferent, doesn't matter. So we're getting closer. We need to get closer than close. We need to actually succeed in abiding in perfect love. The one identity. It's like a medicine that we have to take. It's like a horse pill. We got to choke it down. Have to take the medicine. No other option but to take this medicine, which is to move, sink into this abidance in perfect love, perfect peace, endlessness, the one identity, that which is unconcerned with any change, with any action, with any concept, with any belief, with any idea. It's unconcerned about anything that arises. It's perfect fullness. It's not emptiness, it's fullness. Perfect fullness already includes everything that could ever arise, that will ever arise. Endlessness is that quality of the feeling of perfect fullness, perfect stability. We need to abide in that. That's what the great gurus, saviors, avatars, masters, they abide in that. They're sent to this world by divine grace, which comes from God. They simply abide in that here in this world and remind us that this is what we need to do. That's all we need to do. That's what my teachers did. They simply were abiding in this truth. Truth of reality, truth of being, of endlessness, of one identity. They just abided in that constantly, effortlessly. They're so blissful, unconcerned about anything that was happening around them as far as being consequential to beingness, to identity. Of course, they were practical in many ways. Whatever needed to be done was done, practical standpoint. But they radiated this feeling of non-concern, unconcernedness. We need to get to that right now. That's the only safety there is in this world, the only safety. It's safe because you realize what you are is not threatened by anything. So it's perfect safety. But we have to realize it. If we don't realize this, we will then be part of the conflict and be full of fear and insecurity. Like I said, the mellow times are over. That's the pseudo-security. It's not the real thing. The times of incivility are upon us. We live in barbaric times. There's been a mass influx into this planet, incarnations of egoic mindsets that are very barbaric, very uncivil, very warlike, very oriented towards conflict and destructivity. It's all by design. Because the ego story, again, all of this happening in the universe is the ego story. It's not God's story at all. God doesn't even have a story. God doesn't need a story. Endlessness is God's story. And that's never changing. Endlessness never changes. It's always overflowing. Ananda Mahima means overflowing bliss. Very nature of reality is constantly overflowing. Endless overflowingness of beingness. And we, that is true right now, will always be true for us in exactly the same measure. We can get it now, today, we can get it some other moment. It'll be exactly the same getting, no difference. If we realize that this abiding in the truth right now, it'll be the same as abiding in this truth at any other moment. A million years in the future will be exactly the same for us. If we did it a million years in the past, it would have been exactly the same as if we're doing it right now. No difference. No difference whatsoever. So keep that in mind. It should be very reassuring for you. Okay, as always, I do this taping outside this evening right now. It's getting a little chilly. Probably should wrap it up. The days are going to be beautiful coming up here in the Bay Area of California. And I look forward to presenting more urgent advice and support, because the times are urgent. As again I say, we're not in the mellow times anymore. It's urgent times. The agitation is upon us. And we need to be urgent in our efforts. Something my teachers have always emphasized. I say the number one quality is urgency. Constantly pressuring me to go faster and faster and faster. Hurry up, hurry up, hurry up. Don't waste any time. Do it right now. Whatever needs to be done for today, do it right now. And what needs to be done tomorrow, do that today also. That's what Sri Anandamaya Ma, one of her sayings, whatever it needs to be done today, do it right now. And whatever needs to be done tomorrow, do that today. She's a great teacher of urgency, constantly pressuring her disciples, devotees, those she's helping, to greater and greater speed and effort and intensity and focus towards abiding in the one identity, dropping the effort to find a replacement for reality, right? As we go back to that, loop back to that, even though you understand everything that's been said and you have a sense of urgency, we all do have some sort of sense of urgency, we also say, yeah, but we want to see what we can come up with as a hypothetical replacement. Even though it's hypothetical, we know that too. We're just kind of very curious about our creative capacity. What can we come up with? We're still curious about that, and we need to accept that. That's not going to change. We need to accept that we do have some curiosity, and we need to work on this, and we will try, if God's grace moves in this way, to look at that more and more and more, because it is literally an obstacle for us. Our own curiosity. We say curiosity killed the cat. Right? At some point, we have to address this, because it is the ultimate stumbling block. And we don't want to stumble at this time. So, for right now, we're going to end this talk, this sharing. And it's great that you've been able to stay with us. Continue the garland of your efforts now in some other vein. Remain resolute. Remain certain that you're going to succeed very, very soon. Very great. That's it. Remain resolute. Remain certain that you're going to succeed very, very soon. Very great. That's it.